Good morning and hey now, PSW staff, clients, and friends joining us. Welcome to Thursday's class. Tomorrow we're going to see our film scoring results for Saturday Night Fever. So I'm looking forward to showing you that. You guys did a great job, so I'm very proud. A few days ago we looked at Wagner, and we did some heavy work, heavy lifting there. Great genius composer. Was kind of a god to Germany and the world, almost, with his music and his ideas and having the total control of his art and his work in the theater and revolutionizing opera. So that was good that we got to learn about that. I think today we'll take it easy. We'll just kind of relax and go through our normal LA little tour thing. So we talked about the Whiskey. That opened in 1964 with the Go-Go Dancers and all those groups that started there. Johnny Rivers was the first one to really start there. Then we also talked about the Forum in Inglewood. That's 1967. Now, the Forum was different than the Whiskey, right? Do you remember? Because that kind of started arena rock, where you could all of a sudden, you could accommodate thousands and thousands of fans and people, bands performing their full albums. Okay, so now let's kind of back up and look at folk music. This isn't really going to be about folk music, but this place gets the start as a kind of a folk music comedian hosting environment. And it's important because if you think of New York in the late 50s, New York had Cafe Wa, The Bitter End, all these little coffee shops in Greenwich Village in the late 50s that would, you know, have Nicholas and May, Woody Allen, Bob Dylan, all these, you know, wonderful little acts getting their start. LA didn't have that quite yet. We're always like a step behind, but then when we get it, we make up for it by being extra great at it. So Doug Weston, this guy, he starts this little coffee shop called the Troubadour, and he opens it up in 1957. Okay, and that's on La Cienega. Holds like 60 people or so. It's now a Sprint store. So, but I mean, big shock, right? That's just. We got to take the good with the bad sometimes with in LA. So he starts this little thing in 1957. So what's going on in that year? The music is mostly Elvis is doing his thing. Everly Brothers, Pat Boone, Sam Cooke comes out with "You Send Me," which is the famous song that we listen to. So a lot of that kind of music is going on. Not really folk music, more still kind of rock and roll music. The Cavern opens in 1957 in England, and that's where the Beatles get their real kind of start, where they're playing every day, all night. So we've yet to kind of see that happen. We're still kind of in the early rock and roll stage. American Bandstand opens in 1957, or begins, with Dick Clark, and that's, you know, going to be a huge thing for artists. And then the final I Love Lucy airs, which again is kind of like the Ed Sullivan Show in a sense, where it's America's kind of, not innocence, but a little bit, you know, the youth counterculture is kind of coming in now. And although the Ed Sullivan was still going on at that time, and I Love Lucy, I mean, these things are great, but now we're seeing kind of the hippie movement and artists kind of speaking up more. And speaking of that, speaking up more, Lenny Bruce gets arrested when the Troubadour opens up in 1957 for using the word schmuck. I know, that sounds kind of funny now, because it's not even a bad word. I mean, at least today it's not, but they didn't like that. Lenny Bruce is a very famous provocative comedian that you've probably heard of, and used satire, used kind of vulgarity sometimes to rouse up people and the cops, and so he gets arrested there. So Doug Weston's kind of hanging out there until about 4 years later, where he opens the location that we know today, the Troubadour. So that's in West Hollywood, on Santa Monica Boulevard, kind of Santa Monica and Doheny. So we were in Germany a few days ago, so we need to get there. We need to get to Troubadour somehow. So let's go to West Hollywood from Germany, and This place is still there today. They're kind of struggling, actually. I think they started a GoFundMe. But we'll just take a look at the history. What's interesting and important about this is that we'll talk about all the groups there, but also as artists, you know, sometimes we need a community. Many times we do, and a venue and a vehicle for expressing our work. Troubadour is really important for being an environment that fostered artists, but also where people got their start, where they made connections. And we'll look at some of those connections, and we'll look at those starts, because it was the first for many people. First performance, first debut. So it's good that there's people like Doug Weston and other people that open up their, like John Paces opening up his studio to let artists flourish. And little do we know that history is being made when certain artists meet other artists, and that, you know, changes the world. So that's kind of an interesting thing that's kind of different with the Troubadour. And we'll take a look at that. Okay, what does Troubadour mean? You know, we can't just be saying these words to look smart. It's like a medieval composer that uses lyric poetry, like love poetry, you know. So when Doug Weston opens it in 1961, you know, it mostly is focused on folk singers and songwriters and kind of some comedians, but it gradually gets into rock acts in the 70s. So the Byrds are at an open mic night on Monday, and they start doing their famous version of Tambourine Man for the first time. This is also the first time that Bob Dylan kind of goes from folk music to folk rock music here at the Troubadour, and he makes that important transition. Elton John performs his first U.S. Show here at the Troubadour in 1970. Neil Diamond introduces him. He will take on the world big time. So he performs at the Troubadour for the first time. Buffalo Springfield in 1966 makes their live debut. You know, I mean, so when I say live debut, this is the first time they're performing. They're getting up on stage. And, you know, we think of these people as very important. And so, you know, they could have been terrified. They could have been nervous. This so much has to do with good luck and good timing. So, James Taylor makes his solo debut here in 1969. And Cheech and Chong are discovered here in 1970 by Lou Adler. They're doing this Monday night thing. And Cheech and Chong, of course, will go on and change the world with their comedy act. So this was also, they were also hosting comedy shows there too. And they're hilarious, and they're also ushering in this new free love, hippie, and most importantly, cannabis. That same year, Glenn Frey and Don Henley, they meet at the bar at the Troubadour. And as we know, they form a little group called the Eagles. So this friendship, partnership gets formed there. 1971, the next year, Tom Waits is discovered there and on Amateur Night. And as we know, Tom Waits is a very famous composer, songwriter, known for his kind of low voice, and also an actor, so super creative guy. The next year, Billy Joel makes his L.A. debut, and as an opening act. So it's funny when you think that these guys are so crazy famous now, but they were opening for people, and so that's a huge thing for us. A few years later, we've talked about this, the famous fight that kind of happens when John Lennon and Harry Nilsson are drunk out of their minds, and they start heckling the Smothers Brothers, and they get kicked out. It's pretty crazy when you kick out a Beatle, you know? I mean, usually they're kind of exempt from everything, but I think they were making kind of a ruckus. 1975, Miles Davis records his album live at the Troubadour. So again, we're not only doing folk and comedians, but now we're doing jazz artists. He was kind of in his fusion era here, but still, I mean, he sees this as an important venue for his audience. Metallica makes their LA debut here, 1982. A few years later, 1986, Guns N' Roses plays a show that gets them signed to Geffen. I mean, when you think of playing a show and then getting signed right after the show, that seems like a Hollywood plot, and it is, but it actually does happen to certain people. Pearl Jam, I guess they used to be called Mookie Blaylock. They perform under their new name Pearl Jam for the first time here in 91 at the Troubadour. Fiona Apple in 96 performs her first live U.S. gig here. All these people are using the stage here at the Troubadour to for their creative talent. And Doug Weston said that it wasn't so much who would pack the place the most, but the artist's integrity, who had the artistry and the sensitivity to come in here and do what a personal, you know, personally what they wanted to do. And all these people that I've named all have a very personal, universal voice, obviously, because they're huge and sell out arenas. But they started off, and they still do in some ways, have a very personal voice where you know their name, and we think of all these songs and all these, and as we know that music can also brings in not just, you know, influences of other music, but also clothing, culture, fashion, shopping, all these things. People change their lifestyle around just an album that comes out. So that's a Troubadour. I actually have not been. I love Dantana's right next door, but I haven't gone to a show there. I would like to. I would love to, actually. And, you know, maybe we will someday. I'm not sure, but we should go and support them. So cool that just on that stage, so many great people were there. So that's a little LA taste of folk and comedy and rock music and people getting their starts. Just remember that everybody got their starts somewhere. Nobody just, you know, overnight shows up on stage with a great microphone and a great voice and all that stuff. People work so hard, and that's what we're doing. So nice little reminder. Okay, love you. Tomorrow's Film Scoring Friday. Can't wait to share that with you. Have a great rest of the day.